Happy Sabbath, Church. These are the announcements for today, Sabbath, October 13, 2018. Our Adventist teachers should be appreciated today across the IAD territory. Also, today through to the 20th, we celebrate Week of Kindness. The Central St. Catherine Campery began yesterday and continues until the 15th. There is a family life meeting after Vespers today. Unit leaders, please remember to create a tally record of the brick donations collected and give such to either Sister Joan Grace Pinnock or Shereen Smith each week. More bricks are available if you need them. Sabbath, October 20th, is the day of the pastor and his family and our annual. So on the 20th, we are going to appreciate and show our pastor and his family love. Also on the 20th is our annual Jamaica night, which has been put on by the senior choir. Also on the 20th, Sister Delicia Brown would like to meet with the two youth ambassadors after Vesper. October 27th is our Children's Day, and parents, please be reminded of their meeting on Monday the 15th for rehearsal. They should be out, between 11 and 3 p.m., and refreshment will be provided. Bible class this afternoon will be done by Elder Ken Wright, Vesper, Sister Carol Smith, Sunday night, Elder Paul Beckford, and Wednesday night, Sister Kristen Thomas. Our Elk Center, that is next door, it's been reopened, and it is now operational, so you can start visiting again. The lovely dinner that we had last year, our church dinner, it's on again this year, December 9th, so you can start preparing and planning for that. Sister Antaf, she's not feeling well, and she's asking that the church remembers her in your prayers. Also, Sister Paulette Harris, she sends thanks to the church for your prayers and your well wishes as her daughter, Shadi Harris, has completed her treatment. Amen. Yes, amen indeed. I have this letter from Sister Anderson, and it says, "To all my brethren in Christ, happy Sabbath to you all. For your visits called and your prayers and your support, she thanks you. When I needed you most, you were there for me. I appreciate it very much. I will always cherish the memory. Every day I hope and pray that we will continue to fight for peace and unity so we can bring others to share the love of Jesus. Let us be true and faithful to our Lord and Master until he comes. The Lord bless you all in Jesus' name. Have a blessed Sabbath from my heart to you all. Thanks for everything, Sister Anderson." Amen. Amen. And please remember those on our sick and shut in and those of us who are in need of prayer. Marion Taylor, James Taylor, Isynth Orr, Dahlia Rose, Edith Reed, Kevon Bennett, Noel Bonick, Lenora Bryan, Ivy Heron, Edna Jackson, Carol Street, Vivian Anderson, Shadi Harris, Noel Grace, and George Jennings. Have a blessed Sabbath.
out now. Happy Sabbath to all the members who are here this morning. Thank you very much. Welcome to church. And I hope and pray you have a very good Sabbath. I was pleasantly surprised when I walked in here this morning. I looked at the front and I saw Sister Anderson. Sister Anderson, it's good to see you. There might be some people who don't remember. Would you like to stand, Sister Anderson, so the brethren can see that you're here? You don't want to stand up? All right. No problem. Oh, she's standing. Thank you very much for coming out. All right. And Sister Pinnock, I know you brought her to church. Thank you very much. I was watching the television. Well, I was hearing when it was going on. And they have opened the health center over here. So you need to avail yourselves of the services of the center. All right. And we're going to invite the mothers and fathers who are here with their babies to come forward, and those brethren who might, and friends who might be supporting them, we ask that you come also. We invite the deacons here also, the elders, and we're going to use song, Blessed Be the Ties That Bind. And while they're coming, we like so also like, okay. Okay, thanks much. You see how many persons are standing here? That's the power of babies. That's what they do. All right, this morning we have here to be blessed Kaidre Xavier Richards. That's correct, right? Kavir? It's a K, right? Not an X. Oh, it's Kaidre Kavir Richards. And that's Kellyanne Amoy Crosses and Kevin Rowan Richards, his son, right? Right. We also have Janelia Khadijah Miller, female child of Andrea Kenesha and Chrisanne Duane Miller. That's correct? All right, and they're here this morning to be blessed. We'll read from Mark 10, and it's from verse 14 to 16. It says, but when Jesus saw it, then they brought little children to him that he might touch them. But the disciples rebuked those who brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was greatly displeased and said to them, let the little children come to me and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of God. Assuredly, I say to you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will by no means enter it. Listen to this part. And he took them up as a children in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed them. We do this every second Sabbath. And sometimes the sentiments expressed are the very same ones, but we're not going to stop saying it. Look here, mothers. You take great care in naming your babies. You sometimes open the Bible at their heads on the bed to Psalm 23. Yeah, I know you do it. You sometimes put them in red to ensure that them are the one that trouble them. Yeah, we know we're Jamaicans. The first chance we get, we send them to school. And we go to school and we ensure that they are taken care of and that you buy their books and you take care of them. And even this week I heard of an unfortunate accident where one child shot another one when they were playing with a gun. And as mothers, we would say, well, as mothers, you would say, no, that couldn't happen to me, no, if I might pit them, you know, I'm not doing back something, you know. Yeah, we do it because of our love for our children. But watch here, there's always another dimension. So sometimes your children come to church at moments like these, and then for a while we don't see them again. And that being the case, we don't see you again. But that can't be the way that a child is grown. We have to lend them to the Lord. We have to, the Bible says, train up a child in the way he should go. And when he is old, you're not depart from it. Part of the training is not just to school, the institution of education. Part of the training is the institution of religion. Taking them to church and ensuring that they are moored, they are anchored in Jesus Christ. But let me tell you why many times you can't take them. Because you're not coming to church yourself. Isn't it sad? But look here, Virgin, we're going to ask that mothers and fathers, we're going to ask that you try your best to take them to church every now and again. They're not going to be made any worse as a result of that decision. That's why I'm going to ask you, please, to do so. These little children who are your heartstrings, they tug at your heart. You look at them and you feel love coming down. The Lord loves them even more. And that is why you need to lend them to the Lord. He will take care of them. Because that's why you brought them here. Because you know that after the red chemise and the Psalm 23 don't work, You have to lead them in the hands of God, don't it? Don't it, Kelly? That's what you know. That's why you have brought them here. And we're happy for all the people who are here, who are showing support, the mothers and fathers, and we're going to ask that when you see them on the street doing anything later on in life, you remember that you were here this morning as a sign of respect and saying that you want to help the growth and development of these children. Those brethren out there in the church, I know that they are also willing so to do. So we're now going to pray. We're going to ask the elders who are here to take the babies in their hands. I take one by the right and you pray.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. As we address you as Father in this setting, it is most appropriate because you are the Father of us all, whether we are small or big, tiny or tall. But in a very special way this morning, we want you to duplicate and replicate that which you did while you were here on earth. When the mothers of Salem brought their little ones to you as our Savior, you did not rebuff them, but rather you said, "Suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of heaven." In this you set the pace and the principle that we should bring our young ones for dedication to your cause. We pray, O God, in a very special way, that you will reach down from heaven and you will touch these babies that you will give them those things which are needful. You have already given them life, and their mothers and fathers and relatives have brought them to your house to ask for a special blessing on them. We pray, O God, that you will keep away from them diseases. We pray, O God, that you will help them to have very good mental acumen so that they'll be able to learn the things which are important in life. Yes, the arithmetic and the biology and all these things, but may they also learn values that will make them to be good, decent human beings. When they come to the age of being of understanding, may they make a decision to follow you all the way and so be saved in your kingdom. We pray a blessing, yes, on the children, but we pray a blessing also on the parents who are gathered here this morning. And we ask that you will help them to guide the youth and these children in the right way, as you have declared in your word that if they are trained properly, they will not depart. We pray, O God, that you will give them the unction of your Holy Spirit and help them to understand that it is not enough to tell the children what to do, but to model that behavior and set a good example by what they themselves do. Lord God, we pray that you be with this church. From week to week, we have children being brought for blessings. But we have also made commitments that we will do our part in helping to grow these children in the fear and nurture of God. May we carry out that conviction and that commitment so that at the end of it all, Jesus will be pleased to say to all those who have obeyed him and followed him, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter thou into the joy of thy Lord." Grant us your grace and peace. And we pray that even as the parents give themselves to you, that they will indeed live the life that is consecrated to you, so that their children will make the same decisions when the time is right. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.
It, I'd like to extend a warm welcome to Brother Everton Boucher. I'm not seeing him right now, but I know he's here, Brother Everton Boucher. He's at the back, Brother Boucher. And Sister Stewart. Sister Stewart is also here. So that's Brother Stewart's wife I'm talking. Brother Stewart up here. So hope you have a good Sabbath, everybody. Welcome to church.
Church is now called to worship. Please stand. Praise is rightfully yours. God in Zion, vows to you must be fulfilled, but
gracious Lord and our Father, we come again today into this your courts. Speak to our hearts as we listen to your voice. When you shall come, save us all into the eternal kingdom, we pray. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.
We will now tune our hearts as we lift praises in the hymn, opening hymn as it is announced.
But before we sing the opening hymn, I take this opportunity to welcome each and every person here this morning to church. It's a great feeling to be alive, and because we're alive this morning, we have made it our business to be in church. And especially to those persons who are visiting with us this morning, I pray that as you worship with us this morning, your hearts will be blessed, and that you'll receive a message so that you'll make a commitment to follow Christ. And also, as you worship today and you make that commitment, there's a greater welcome that awaits you. So prepare your hearts to be with Christ when he comes the second time. And at that note, we'll make use of hymn number 34, Wake the Sun.
Of our faith as given to us in Exodus 20, verses 8 to 11, and St. John's 14, 1 to 3.
Sunday to keep it holy. 6 days shall thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work. Neither thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy servant, nor thy stranger that will be in thy gates, nor thy stranger that will be in thy gates. For this is the Lord blessed in heaven and earth. So you are in the Lord that let him his, and in the rest of the Sabbath day. Therefore, in the Lord, yes, the Sabbath day, and hallow it. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, you also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I will prepare a place for you. I will come again and give to you myself. That here I am, here may be also.
Be seated. We will now bless by a song from Touch of Grace.
That is so fitful, a name so wonderful to me. This name is worthy of all praises, because of him I am made free. That name is Jesus. Oh, how who gave his life for me, because of love so unconditional, I will have life eternally. To my storm clouds, the name speaks calm unto my fears, and when I feel like no one loves me, his loving presence is so near. That name is Jesus. Oh, how the one who His heart was broken, mine was mended. He became sin, now I am clean. The cross he carried bore my burdens. The nails that held him set me free. His life for mine, his life for mine. How could it ever be that he would die, God's Son would die to save for mine. His scars of suffering brought me healing. He spilled his blood to fill my soul. His crown of thorns made me royalty. His sorrow gave me joy untold. His life for mine, his life for mine. How could it ever be that he would die, God's Son would die
and I will
He gave his life for mine.
Amen, church. Oh, what love divine God has given himself for us. My brothers and sisters, good afternoon. I am very happy today to know that I am in the courts of the Lord. It is not of any good things that we have done while we are here. Psalmist David said, I was glad when they say unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice in it. I have a passion for God's word, as you hear from the person who introduced me. But it was never always so, my friend. I don't know if it has to do with my name. Don't know how did my mother get the name Calvin. I don't know. One thing I know, she was not a religious person per se. She was not well read, so I don't know if she has known anything about John Calvin. There was a time when I was going to school. I used to wonder what is the meaning of my name. Because my mother called me Calvin, but he called the brother that born before me Melvin. So I was wondering why. So I start to do some little research. I start to learn about the great John Calvin, in whose shoes I am not able to walk. Brothers and sisters, I was doing chemistry. I found that there was an experiment, and in that experiment, the experiment was called Melvin Calvin. Then I came back and I looked in the diary. No, before that, I'm going to tell you something that happens to me. Left this country in 1987. I never came back. Came back to visit 1990 for 2 weeks. Then I went back to school and came back 1993, August 22nd. Went to work in the Ministry of Agriculture 1994, January 24. By April, I got a summons. Man rode to my office, asked for me, is your name Calvin Thompson? I said, yes. Said, I have a summons for you. Said, for what? Told me, somewhere about 1989, drove a car and hit down someone in Portmore. It's now some years now, and they decide to settle the account. So I was so disturbed. I told them, the man is not me. I was not here. I can't even drive fly. Man said, this is your name. He left it in my desk and walked away. Not knowing what to do, I asked the ministry, if there is anybody by that name in the Ministry of Agriculture. One gentleman told me, yes. Never want to know anything further. So I took the summons and went back to Hope Road, right at Arden Road. Enter the building and place it on the desk and say, it's not me, and walk out. I would not betray my brother. And I would not help them to find my brother. I don't know which one it is. So I searched the directory and I found 6 Calvin Thompson.
So it was not easy to pluck out which one. Today I stand before you to speak on behalf of God's word. I have in my hand a very old Bible. I want you to see it. Very, very old. But it is called a preacher's Bible. It's a preacher's Bible because one day in 1984, a man in my church in Craighead gave it to me. He told me, I want you to make use of this Bible. This is a gift from my sister in America. But I want you to make. I carry this Bible with me everywhere I go. Everywhere I go, this Bible is with me. Tattered and torn, my brothers and sisters. And I know that one day my eyes will give way. And I will not be able to see some of the writings here. So, I tried to reverse some things, and it gives me some help. I loved it so much. It is the only Bible that I don't give my family to play with. Today, I want to speak to you a little bit on a topic. Call it the four chariots of Zechariah. Four chariots, and let us turn back to the scripture reading. I want everybody to be there. Zechariah 6, verse 1 to 8, which was so ably read by Brother Brown. But I want to put a little passion in this because it means much. Zechariah is the second to last book in the Old Testament. Haggai, then Zechariah, then Malachi. So we close the Old Testament. After we read Zechariah, we want to turn our Bibles to Zechariah chapter 6 and verse 1 to 8. In this setting, my friend, Zechariah, prophet of God, had 8 visions. Whether they are consecutive visions, the Bible did not tell. But he had 8 visions. And if one man in a short period of time got 8 visions, it must be something important that God wants to tell his people. In fact, his contemporary, Haggai, was bringing the very same message to a people in his land. Brothers and sisters, the call of Zechariah to the prophetic ministry in a time when Israel, returning from Babylonian captivity, become indifferent over rebuilding of the temple of God. Haggai chapter 2 and verse 6. He eloquently put forward the problems that exist as it relates to Israel's attitude towards God's church. He said, thus speaketh the Lord of hosts, saying, the people say, the time is not come, the time that the Lord's house should be built. Is it time for you, O ye that dwell in your sealed houses, and this house be in waste? Now therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways. Ye have sown much and bring in little. Ye eat, but ye have not enough to drink. Ye drink, but ye are not filled with drink. He clothes you, but there is none warm. And he that earneth wages to put in bags with holes. Why? Verse 9. He gave us the explicit answer. He looked for much, and lo, it came in little. And when he brought it home, I did blow upon it because of mine house that is waste, and ye run every man unto his own house. These were the burdens and the hearts of these two prophets as Israel become indifferent to God's house of praise. Zechariah chapter 1 and verse 7, we pick up the first vision. Upon the 24th day of the 11th month, which is the month of Sebai, in the second year of Darius, came the words of the Lord to Zechariah the son of Berechiah, the son of Iddo, the prophet, saying, I saw by night, and behold, a man riding upon a red horse. And he stood among the myrtle trees that were in the bottom, and behind him were red horses, speckled and white. Then said I, O my Lord, what are these? And the angels which talked with me said unto me, I will shew thee what these things be. Verse 10, and the man that stood among the myrtle trees answered and said, These are those whom the Lord has sent to walk to and fro through the earth. And they answered the angels of the Lord that stood among the myrtle trees and said, we have walked to and fro through the earth. And behold, all the earth sitteth and is at rest. My brothers and sisters, fellow members of God's Seventh-day Adventist Church, this condition outlined is a condition that presently fit the trouble of our present church, which the Lord at his coming shall find a spiritual kingdom, a church which the apostle outlined, the Lord at his second coming shall receive him. A glorious church without spot, without wrinkle, or without anything that is outside of his word. Readings of this was further given to us, if you'll read Songs of Solomon 6 and verse 10. Let's turn our Bibles quickly. We are not going to be here for very long. We have read very well the passage of Scripture. Who is she that looketh forth as the morning, fair as the moon, clear as the sun, and terrible as an army with banner? In Great Controversy, page 425, we read, Sister White puts it this way, clad in the armor of Christ's righteousness, the church has entered its final conflict. Fair as the moon, clear as the sun, and terrible as an army with banner. But what do these mountains mean? According to Zechariah 8 and verse 3, we'll find the answer. Turn your Bibles. Thus said the Lord God, I am returned unto Zion, and will dwell in the midst of Jerusalem. And Jerusalem shall be called the city of truth, and the mountains of the Lord's host, his holy mountain. Thus, the mountain must represent the dispensation of church history, when the church is able to withstand the storm of worldly infiltration and lust, a time when it is clean and a fit place for the dwelling of the holy presence of our Lord God Almighty. My brothers and sisters, Isaiah 32 and verse 2, in this church, the Bible says, the holy presence of the Lord Almighty and is for the saints a mighty fortress, and a dwelling and hiding place from the wind, a covert from the tempest, as a rivers of water in a dry season. Does the shadow of a great rock in a weary land. Here Isaiah was speaking of Israel's experience as they traveled through the desert from Egypt to Canaan. Bible says that when they murmured against Moses, "Give us water," Moses spoke to God, "What shall I do? These people are here crying out." God told Moses, "Speak to the rock. Thou will give them water." Also, Moses have done one thing. In his anger, he struck the rock. The water come forth. He said, "Jinky rebels." That acts, my friend, not committed willingly, but because of the state of his mind, has barred him from setting his foot on the promised land. My brothers and sisters, as we look at our key text, we are going to look at a few things. I want to look at these four horses. These horsemen in the Bible, what is it telling us? What effect has that on us today? We're going to look. The Bible says, "Then answered the angel that talked with me, 'What are these, my Lord?' And the angel answered and said, 'These are the four spirits of the heavens which goeth forth by standing before the Lord on earth.'" Want you to look at Revelation chapter 6 and compare the vision of Zechariah with that of John. In verse 6, he said, "The black horse which therein goeth into the north country, and the white goeth forth after them, and the grizzled go forth towards the south country, and the bear went forth and sought the one that they might walk to and fro to the earth. And he said, 'Get the ends, walk to and fro to the earth.' So they walk to and fro to the earth. Then cried he unto me, they spake unto me, saying, 'Behold, these that goeth to the north country have quieted my spirit in the north country.'" This is where I'm going to focus my message today. In the time after writing of Zechariah, it was under the Persian dispensation. Around 520 BC, very little is known in history about the great empire of the Persian, because when Greece overthrew Persia and they wiped out the records of the Persian Empire, so that Greece, the everything about Grecian must be dominated, the Greeks saw the Persians as people who were apostate. Those people were living luxurious life. They were known for rugs. They were known for these wonderful cloths that they were made. One of the greatest cities that the earth has ever seen was the capital of Persia. Amidst this, my friend, God has raised up a man, Darius. After 70 years of Israel into Babylonian captivity, he has overthrown now those wicked Babylonians and have in his heart some sort of likeness for the people of God. So he sent them back to Jerusalem to rebuild God's temple and to worship God in spirit and in truth. But my brothers and sisters, as the Israelites who were crying a few years before Psalm 137 will tell you what they did there. As they sat, they say, by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. We hang our harps and willows. The wicked has carried us away. Captivity then require from us a song. But how can we sing the Alpha's song in a strange land? After 70 years, Ezekiel has pleaded to God. Isaiah has pleaded to God. You have had indignation against your people for this 70 years. What is going to happen to your people? God heard the prayers of the saints, my friend, and he has raised up a man not of their faith to go back, build the temple, and worship God, my friend. But Israel became hard-hearted. They were so interested in how they live, while God's house turned his train. This is the setting under which God has to send prophets after prophets. But he reminds them what has happened. So we know the north country is a country that was north of the blessed land, Palestine, which was Babylon. The south country is Egypt. According to Genesis 13, verse 1 and 2, that when they were up there and that there was a famine in the land, that Abraham went down to Egypt, to the south country. While the Israelites were in Babylonian captivity, they start to partake of the customs of Babylon. God was displeased. So he said, those that enter the north country have quieted my spirit in the north country. Today, my brothers and sisters, as we go throughout life, where is our north country? For many of us, we look to the great United States, which is north of us, for the answers to our problems. We have sacrificed many times our children, our life, on the altar of the Almighty Dollar. We have not bring forth God's word as it should be in the North Country. North Country might be one that is outside of your gate, outside of your door, outside of your house in Kitson Town. Those that enter the North Country have quieted my spirit in the North Country. Consider this. When Israel marched out of Egypt, the Lord, my brothers and sisters, have led them right through the wilderness. Pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. Wheresoever the cloud rested, there Israel pitched their tents. Some years after the Israelite nation have settled in the land of Canaan, the promised land, they become indifferent, my friend. Indifferent, start to eat and drink and forget the Lord. And so God, as it were, looked down and saw what Israel, the selected one, the one that should bring a word to the people around, the one that should teach the heathen nation about God, indulging in the things of Babylon. So in 2 Chronicles chapter 36, we pick up the story of what happens to Israel. 2 Chronicles 36. Let us turn our Bibles, my brothers and sisters. 2 Chronicles chapter 36. The Bible depicts the condition of Israel prior to going into Babylonian captivity. It is not that God has not helped them, but they, my friend, let us turn to verse 14 to 20. Moreover, all the chief priests of the people transgressed very much after all the abomination of the heathen and polluted the house of the Lord which he has hallowed at Jerusalem. And the Lord God of their father sent to them by messengers, rising up betimes and sending because he had compassion on his people and on his dwelling place. The Bible states in verse 16, but they mocked the messengers of God and despised his word and misused his prophets until the wrath of the Lord arose against his people till there was no more remedy. This is what I find to be the hardest thing for God to do. Therefore, in verse 70, he brought upon them the king of the Chaldees, whom slew their young men with the sword in the house of their sanctuary, and had no compassion upon him that stooped for age, the young men or maiden. He gave them all into his hands, and all the vessels of the house of God, great and small, the treasures of the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king and of the princes, all these brought he to Babylon. They burned the house of God, break down the walls of Jerusalem, burn all the palaces thereof with fire, and destroy all the goodly vessels thereof. Them that were escaped from the sword carried he away to Babylon, where there were servants to him and his sons until the reign of the kingdom of Persia. Today, my brothers and sisters, we have come this far by faith, leaning on the Lord, trusting in his holy word. He never fails us yet. In the ranks of God's church, we are only servants, servants of God, and a friend to man. Don't know how many of you used to be here when we have MV. That was our motto, Elder. That was our motto. We have no more motto than to be a servant of God and a friend to man. This is our sole purpose on earth. But I turn your eyes now. We're going to look at these horses as they come to us, either in Zechariah or in Revelation. But let us turn to look at it in Revelation chapter 6. Bible says, in the first chariot were red horses, which denotes bloodshed, according to Revelation 6, verse 3 and 4. When he has opened the second seal, there went out another horse that was red, and power was given to him that is set thereon to take peace from the earth, and that they should kill one another. And there was given unto him a great sword. Its whiteness denotes purity of the propagated gospel. The color red shows the corruption which crept in the Christian church after the apostolic age. Speaking of the second century, James Warris says, and I quote, "Christianity begun already to wear the garb of heathenism. The seed of most of those errors that aforetime so enterly overrun the church, marred its beauty, tarnished its glory, and already begin to take place by that time. The mighty Roman Catholic Church was little more than the Roman Empire baptized. Rome was transformed as well as converted. Christianity could not grow up through Roman civilization and paganism. However, without in turns being colored and influenced by the rites, festivals, and ceremonies of the old polytheism, Seventh-day Adventist Church was raised up with a message of hope, fear God, and give glory to him. For the hour of his judgment is come. Worship him who made the heaven, the sea, and the fountains of water." My brothers and sisters, thus the red horse of Zechariah were not shown to go anywhere, but symbolizes the shed blood of the fallen Christian martyrs here on earth for their faith in AD 538. Then the second chariots were black horses, a figurative language for bondage. The black horse fitly represents the spiritual darkness and degeneracy that characterized the church from the time of Constantine to the establishment of the papal supremacy. According to Philip Scaff, but the elevation of Christianity as a religion of state presents also an opposite aspect of our contemplation. It involves great risk of degeneracy to the church. The Christianizing of the state amounted there to the great measure of paganizing and secularizing the church. The mass of the Roman Empire was baptized only with water, not with the spirit of the gospel, and is swallowed into heathen manners and practice into the sanctuary of God. Only when the church finds herself drifting, only when the church finds herself grounded on the reef of her own folly, with the wave of divine retribution beating over her head, then she must realize that where there is no vision, the people perish. And if we do not live up to the vision that we have, we shall likewise perish. My brothers and sisters, but because we have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure, where the billows roll, fastened to the rock, which cannot move, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. Jeremiah 12 and verse 5, he asked the question, "If you run with the footmen and they weary thee, how will thou contend with the horses? And if in the valleys of peace wherein thou trustest, they weary thee, how shall we stand the swelling of Jordan?" This is God's word. This is how it goes, my friend. Hebrew 1 and verse 10 tells us where we are standing as a church. We need not to doubt. We need not to doubt, my friend. Jesus Christ being the chief cornerstone, we have a foundation whose maker and builder is God. And so we are encouraged in Isaiah 54, verse 11 and 13. We are encouraged by Isaiah. Oh, thou afflicted, tossed with tempest and not comforted. Behold, I will make thy windows of agates and thy gates of carbuncles and all thy borders of present stone, and all thy children shall be taught of the Lord, and the children shall be taught of the Lord, and great shall be the peace of thy children. Come to this church for 39 years. After all, this church is a university. I learned these things nowhere but at the feet of the Sabbath school. If we search and ask God, God will help us to learn. If we come to Sabbath school, it is the only school I know in which we are not corrupted. And I speak these words with no apology, because I have gone through, I have studied great theologies, I have read many things, I have gone through the evolution story. Upon that, my friend, I have no foundation. I can only say that the little Bible that we have in our hand is the hope and the ground for salvation. Life is in it. Read it. Symbolic language describes the people who shall rise up in the spiritual kingdom. Ephesians 2 verse 20. By the foundations are prefigured the founders. By her windows of agates through which the light shine, her prophets. And by her walls of carbuncles, the watchman which shall take charge and watch and look. My father, my brothers and sisters, while the borders of pleasant stone depict the members that shall beautify the house, the valley between these two mountains depict the period when the church is at its lowest ebb. This is why we have to preach today. For we know that these two mountains cannot be carried away. In the first century, the church was pure, white, but it became tainted. There will come a time, my brother, when the church will rise from where it is to the top. We will reach a spiritual height again. Bible said, for I, the day will come, said the Lord of hosts, when I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. God will never leave his church. No matter what we see day by day. Hold on. Hold on. Ride on, King Jesus, to victory. Ride on with power and glory. Ride on, King Jesus, ride on. As I close, my brothers and sisters, let us look at what God wants us to do as a Seventh-day Adventist church. We are here. We are here to present God's word to a dying world. Amen. There is, my friend, only one gospel. Announced in Eden. Preached to Abraham. Announced on the children of Israel. And proclaimed anew in every generation. In its development, my brothers and sisters, the gospel meets the needs of every crisis in the world's history. John the Baptist, in his preaching, announced the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Prepare ye the way for the Lord. Make his path straight. My brothers and sisters, as I close, we are standing on holy ground. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. The church is here to proclaim God's message. And I have read the hearts of our founding fathers have cried out when they see the condition that exists within our ranks. Want you, when you go home, to read Testimony, Volume 5, page 217 and verse 218. If you haven't, read it. Maybe I can paraphrase it because I studied it. I would implore every preacher to read it. Mr. White says in 1905, I am saddened when I see the condition of our people. Lord has not closed heaven to us, but our course of continuous backsliding is separating us from our God. Grievous and presumptuous sins are in our midst. Yet the general feeling is that the church is flourishing and peace and prosperity is in all of her borders. The church has gone back from following after Christ, her leader, and are steadily drifting towards Egypt. Yet few are alarmed at the want of spiritual power. Church has gone back from following after Christ, her leader. My brothers and sisters, we are the church of the living God. We must stand up and be counted. I have stand. My greatest problems, I must tell you, as a family, is that when I leave the scene of action, when I am dead and in my grave, what will become of my two children within the church? It bothers my heart every day because it seems to me that sometimes we are not seeing what is overrunning us. I've heard this week a very strange thing in England. And I must tell you, a woman gave birth to a child. It is only mothers who give birth. Let me tell you, fathers don't give birth. While the world is trying their very best, men became women. Women became men. It's only mothers who give birth. She was a woman, she said, when she got pregnant. She gave birth to a baby girl. But she said, she is now a man. The child now must get a birth certificate. On that birth certificate, the mother's name should be there. They don't know what to put there. They are now contemplating that seeing as the scene has shifted, why can't you put on the birth certificate, parent? Not a mother's name anymore. Parent! Parent! Now that little child grows up, on her birth certificate when she comes of age, see on that birth certificate, parent, what does that mean? Who is my mother? And who is my father? Is it that my mother becomes my father? Or is it my father is my mother? My brothers and sisters, England is now contemplating what to do. There is no place, as it is now by law, that the word parents can go on the birth certificate. Everything would have to change. What are we doing in this dying world of sin? My brothers and sisters, this is the purpose of the Church of the Living God. We are here to to proclaim God's word as it stands in the Bible. Yes. When the woman give birth, doesn't matter what you want to say or who you want to say you are. You are what God made you. So my brothers and sisters, I can only implore you. Only implore you to serve God. So I close with a statement made by Joshua in Joshua chapter 24. My brothers and sisters, let us close in Joshua 24, 14, verse 15. We read, and I take my seat. Now, therefore, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and truth. Put away the God which your father served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt and serve the Lord. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose he this day whom will ye serve, whether the God which your fathers served were on the other side of the flood, or the God of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as be for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Would for God today that we may give ears to his word. Would for God that we may set our house in order. Would for God that we, the ones who have grown up, start to contemplate what type of world are we living for the children that we have. May God help us as we go to care for those whom God has given us, that in the days when he shall come and ask, where is this the beautiful flock that I have given you, that we may be able to present them before God as he wishes. May the blessed Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ keep us faithful unto the end. This is my wish. This is my hope. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen, brethren. Our closing hymn is 348, the Church as One Foundation.
Church as one foundation.
us close our eyes for the benediction. Grace to you and peace from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen.